Hi guys, follow me on Instagram to never ever miss any of my crazy updates. Hi guys and welcome to another vlog. I'm driving this. This is the Land Rover Defender and look at the car, my goodness. Because it is on the off-road height, it looks so freaking tall. It is 2 meters wide, it is 5 meters long, it has a wheelbase of 3 meters. This is the Defender 110. Let's open this. First things first, let me find how... I press that button. There it goes. Hydraulic struts, of course. And it says Land Rover Ingenium right there. Insulation has to be there, of course. But you know what? The engine bay isn't as massive the car is itself. Let's close this. And let me tell you that this car has something known as the black pack or something of that sort. So, you know, Defender is written in black, gloss black. The grille is also gloss black, but the grille is very chintu-bintu here on this car. You get a front camera right there. You can see that. Massive bumper as such. You get front parking sensors, of course, skid plate, and the whole design has been done to give it excellent approach angle, departure angle, breakover angle and whatnot. But we'll talk about that later, of course. Now, you know, the only resemblance with the old Defender is this round shape for the LED DRL. This is the main light, and this one doesn't get the matrix lights, but these are all LED units because this is the SE, not the HSC. So some features are missing. The top variant is the first edition. This is obviously for the indicator. Again, the DRL right there, gloss black finishing. The fog lamp is very small. It's like chintu bindu, like really tiny as such. I don't know why, but the design of this car gets 10 on 10. This is the modern version of the Defender, and my goodness, it looks absolutely mind-bogglingly sensational. Okay, here you see, this is kind of plastic, but you know, this is so that it doesn't slip your stuff. You can keep your lunch here and eat, obviously, when the car is not in motion, that is, from the side. But before coming to the side, let me show you the wheels on this car. These are massive 20 inch wheels. 255 60 20 is the size of the tires, and these alloy wheels actually look quite nice. I like the design of the alloys. They have this sort of a matte blackish, grayish finish, whatever. There you can see the air suspension, and because it is on off-road height, there is so much space right there. You get this black body cladding running throughout the vehicle, and this is fake AF, says Defender right there. But this is fake, and you know, just so that they can do the symmetry of design. I'll tell you what exactly is there on the other side, which is actually functional. But coming to the side of the car, look at this Defender 110. You know, it's 110 because it has a longer wheelbase. The Defender 90 is a 3-door, this is the 5-door. Longer wheelbase is like massive, more than 3 meters. That's like absolutely mind-boggling. The car is humongous, that's what she said. And here you have a camera. Okay, there are so many cameras on this car, it's absolutely baffling. You see, this light is blinking right now. This is for the indicator. And you know what? This mirror obviously gets electric adjust. Okay, it has got auto dimming. It has got heated function. It has got memory function. Wow, it is absolutely, everything on this car is insane. I can't even show you the roof of the car. This car is taller than me. I feel so ajeeb right now. But you know what? I'm still going to climb and try to show you. The roof rails are actually finished in black again, and the roof is massive. You know what? This roof can actually take 300 kgs. You can actually camp here, put a tent and camp. 300 kgs when the car is not moving, of course. When it's moving, it's lower. Still, this is a shark fin antenna, but it's more than a shark fin antenna. I'll tell you in a bit why. Meanwhile, you know why this design element is there. Because on the outside here, you see that, you know, it's not continuous glass, but on the inside, it's actually the pillar. And this is like a dividing opinion, but you can have a lot of accessories like a washer gun or something, or a storage space as well. In case the storage space on the inside isn't sufficient enough, you will be really stupid to actually think that, because there's so much storage space on offer. Okay, this is where actually you fill a lot of petrol in this car. This is a petrol version of the Defender. Massive tires. And you know what? This is actually not a body on frame platform. The Land Rover Defender doesn't stay true to its heritage. It's gone for a monocoque chassis, but still it looks so huge, humongous. Spare wheel mounted at the rear, tailgate mounted spare wheel. By the way, this spare wheel is the same size as all other tires. So yes, you don't get space savers. You are in the middle of nowhere. You get a puncture. You need a full size spare wheel. That's what Land Rover believes, and that they believe it right. Okay, you see there's a camera here. Yeah, this camera is not for the reverse parking. This is for the clear side camera of the rear view mirror, inside rear view mirror, which I'll show you in a bit later, that is, of course, because the actual camera is here for the reverse parking camera. And this is a spray which cleans the camera, obviously, because of the position of the camera so low, you need it. Rear parking sensors, says Defender SE right there. Land Rover logo there. And you've got proper functional exhaust. No fake stuff happening on this car. You can see it gets independent suspension as well. plenty of ground clearance. The car looks absolutely mind-bogglingly phenomenally big. Okay, with the off-road height, it's so good. I love it. Okay, these are the lights, and this gets this square treatment LED units, of course. But these cubes are like really small. This is actually to pay respect or homage to the older Defender. It says Defender SE, which I think I've already told you, but I was expecting the press car to be actually an HSE or a first edition at least. Okay, this is actually how the indicators work, like very small and gentle. And like I showed you, this happens to be the fog light. They've actually done silver finishing on the bumper, really reduces the visual bulk by quite an extent. And this rear windscreen is so big now, you need a massive wiper. That wiper is hidden, you don't get to see the wiper unless and until it's functional. Land Rover simply likes to hide the wipers of the car. That's what they do with all their Range Rover models, at least. Let's open this. Okay, now the boot is actually, I think, around 180 liters with all the three rows up. First and foremost, this opens sideways. Takes a little bit of an effort to open for sure, but then, you know, it kind of stabilizes, and it is actually not that heavy as much as I expected it to be. You have a handle here to pull and push. That's good. Okay, here it says Defender, just in case you forget which car you are in. Of course, in this storage space everywhere, this is where the warning triangle is there, and there's something which I don't want to show you, but I still have to show you. You got it? Yeah. I mean, I don't know why it is like that, but that's how it is. Now, this car doesn't have the towing wala thingy, which is an optional accessory, by the way. That towing thing can make this car tow up to 3.5 freaking tons. 3,500 kgs, that's insane. Okay, now this is made of cloth. It's very convenient, I'll tell you why. You can easily open this up. I mean, it's hinged at multiple places. You can just like, okay, I have to take some effort. Most of these things now, okay, actually it's a one-hand job. I'm not pulling it right. Now I'm pulling it right. There, I have removed this. And I can just pack it up straight away. There, you see. I've removed it. Now the boot has become massive, and even with all the three rows up, there's still a proper cup holder. So when you recline the seats, the cup holders don't go. AC vents here, I mean AC controls are here in the rear, and this is for a bottle. So it's a very practical cabin. In fact, there is a 12 volt charging socket. There's an air conditioning vent right there. Wow, air conditioning vent, airbags, whatnot. There's actually storage, I think, for the first aid kit. Really practical. There's a hook, and my goodness, this is so, I mean, super practical. Now, the best thing is that, you know what, it's so high right now. How do I load and stuff? Press this button, and then I can actually decline the ride height of the car. Yeah, I can lower the car. You can see the car is getting lowered. And once I lower the car, it just becomes easier to stuff in things. That's, again, super duper awesome. Now, what I can do, I can also recline the seat like this. Press a button here. And yeah, actually that's for pushing the seat. That's something we need to do from the front. I'm doing it from the wrong place. I'm so sorry about that. Now, this car has one of the most useless third row seats ever, because there you go, it's easy to put it up and down. Here I'm just going to put it like this. It's a 50-50 split seat, the third row, but there's no space on offer. It's not for kids, it's for aliens, to be honest, because there's not much space on offer. I just put it back here. The problem here is that although there's no space, there are these awesome safari windows. So when you go out for a safari, basically, when you go to a jungle safari, you can see animals from here. That is so cool. I love this treatment. This is amazing. But you know what? No legroom, boss. Can't really sit there, unfortunately. Okay, I'm just going to like close the door here, and it closes with a proper thud. I've reclined the ride height, of course. Now let's get in. The doors are so big. The thing is that the doors don't open as wide as you would expect, but they're super wide still. The Altos have set a different benchmark altogether, and I don't know why I keep bringing it all the time. Okay, let's push this back into place. Yeah, you can recline the seat. Seat has some recline going on, and you can obviously pull it up. I mean, push it front or back. That's also pretty cool. Although at this price point, the third row should have had a button for electric retracting and all those things. Now, the door pockets are big enough, but everything is rubberized. A lot of plastic and rubber in this car. You see this? This will actually warn you if someone is there behind, so you don't end up hitting someone and knocking off the door of the car. Getting in and out is easy because there's a massive handle right there. You just can pull and get inside. Meanwhile, okay, you can recline the seat like this, just in case if you want to recline the seat to increase the boot carrying capacity, you can do that. And this is upright, you can push it back. All this is very convenient. Now, most of you will be like, just push it ahead. Here, I'm going to push it all the way ahead. Can you sit there? No, I cannot sit there. You see, the seats are so terrible. this is not for humans. This was not designed by Samsung, because Samsung designs for humans apparently. Okay, that's a very bad and poor joke, but you will get it. These are useless seats. No need for this to be a 7-seater. But there are multiple seating options in this car, which we will talk about in a bit. Here, I'm going to push this all the way back. Now, thing is, if you want to charge anything in this car, no problem. This is a proper charging station. First and foremost, let me get inside. Side running boards would have been nice. But anyways, you climb inside and you realize that there is actually a USB socket right here. And this is actually a holder if you want to put an iPad or a tablet. That's cool. Meanwhile, okay, you get magazine holder, scooped out seat back, good amount of leg room, good amount of under thigh support, good amount of headroom, lot of sweat on my face right now. But a lot of light is coming in as well, because you get a massive panoramic roof. There's a light here on the top. See, the door is open. Let me shut it. And shuts with a proper thud. Got wood treatment right there. You see, window is actually large enough. I love this. This is so freaking cool. There's a hook, there's a handle, and obviously this is for the mic probably. Meanwhile, no height adjustable seat belts. That's a glaring omission. Massive center console right there. Okay, it has actually got this has got a 3-zone climate control system. So although, you know, you have got separate dials, both of them work together, and this sync thing is actually blocked out, so you can't lock it. Now, I mean, the AC is very functional. AC vents are here. But none at the top, none at the B pillar or any of that sort. So just here, you're relying centrally here. And of course, at the rear, you've got here on the pillar. But, you know, it could have got more vents at the rear for sure. Still, AC does a great job, because the cabin is so freaking wide and flat. Three people here, absolute mind-boggling comfort without a doubt. Okay, now there is a 12-volt charging socket, and there are two USB charging sockets. So it's like a charger's delight. So many charging ports, that's obnoxious. And you know what, exposed screws. Everywhere you get these exposed screws for that retro charm. Now you can obviously put this seat down as well. Very easy to put the seats down as such. I mean, if you want to increase the carrying capacity. And it gets ISOFIX child seat anchors. Yeah, ISOFIX child seat mounts. Now this thing actually also opens, but on this particular car, I'm not too sure how it opens, but you can actually remove this and then make it flat and all. So plenty of, oh yeah, that's my Land Rover cap. I've been waiting since almost 1.5 years to get a Land Rover to drive, because it's been so long. They have not really launched many cars in India as such. That is the dashboard design, which looks absolutely stunning, functional, rugged, and any other adjective I want to use, I just throw at it, because it's just amazing. I love it. Okay, let's get outside. Only thing, it's so freaking wide and tall, it's kind of difficult to get in and out, and it becomes a task for sure. Now this is the thing I was talking about. This is actually functional. Okay, these are air vents to draw in air. Where what you can do, you can opt for a snorkel. So this is going to, I mean, this area is going to be used for a snorkel from here and all the way to the top. This is why this design element is there. It's all more about function, but still there is so much eye candiness to this car. Looks absolutely stunning. There's a request sensor on all the doors. However, you have to press a button. It does not, it doesn't just open the door just if you put your hand. You have to actually press a button to do that. There are cameras everywhere, you name it, there are cameras. Let's get inside. First and foremost, let me do one thing. Let me turn off this indicator, which is ringing since some time now. Okay, everything is so rubberized now that it's insane. It's absolutely insane. Quality of materials is really very nice. Yeah, you can punch it, and that's how good it is, because it's functional, it's durable, and it's not going to like become bad after some time. White is not the best choice though, but it still looks really nice. Like, it looks so funky. White looks so funky, and exposed screws are so awesome. I love them. Okay, you've got memory seats for the driver as well as the co-driver. You've got three settings, and this is obviously to remind you, do not just get out of the car. There's someone behind probably. Now, these are the controls for the power window. This is for the rear view mirrors. You select this and you can operate the left mirror and whatever. And this is for the child lock function, which child locks the doors, the rear doors. So you don't have to put some screw in. By the way, this is to open the hood of the vehicle, and this is this lock. Okay, so that you don't open it while driving the car. Who the F actually opens the hood of the car while driving the car? The only person I can think of who can come close to doing such a thing is probably Ajay Devgan. I'm just kidding. Okay, again, you get proper grip there for the dead pedal, and this is, I think, for the headlight leveler. This is the electric parking brake of the vehicle, and you get a 12-way electric adjust for the driver's seat. But you know what, in the HSE trim, you actually get a 14-way adjust. Here you get a 2-way manual adjust for the headrest. In that, you get a 4-way. You know what's the difference? Actually, the HSE gets 2 plus more functions for the adjustment of the seats, which are very good, but you know, overstaffed or overdone in terms of you know, lumbar support. It has so much support here on the back. It's absolutely insane. The seats are humongous and awesome. However, This being the lower trim does not get the cooling function, that is the ventilation function or the heated function, which is there in the HSC variant. Okay, getting in and out very easy. You can hold on to anything and just like get inside. Exposed grooves everywhere. I freaking love that. There's storage space here. But when you talk about storage, there is so much storage in this car. It's absolutely crazy why they have so much storage in this car. You know what? I was thinking I can shift in this car temporarily because there's so much storage on offer. It's absolutely mind-boggling. You know, they expose screws everywhere and there's this wood treatment, which I honestly find it out of place having wood in this car because everything else is about plastic and like a lot of rubber. In fact, yeah, this is plastic. Yeah, that's right. This is plastic. Okay, I'm just going to shut the air conditioning. Plenty of plastic. This is rubber. Okay. And this everything is a handle. You can hold on to whatever you feel like. Okay, you have a handle on the top, but there should have been a handle here as well. It would have just been easier to get in and outside. I mean, that's what I honestly feel. In order to turn on the light, very easy, press this button. Like, it's a touch sensitive light. There, you can turn on the light, as easy as it gets. And this is for the SOS function. This is for service, I believe. There is a sunglass holder right on the top. Now, this is to open the sunblind, this is to open the sunroof of the car. Here, we are going to open the sunroof of the car. Now, you press it once, it is just going to open like thoda sa khulega, not the full thing. Now, you press it once again, then it will open. Actually, it opens a small window to get in fresh air. That's about it. It doesn't open as big as you would expect. But hey, you know, at least it opens big enough because there's some Land Rover cars in which you have a panoramic roof, but it doesn't open at all. All right, now the glove box is actually disappointing for me because it's actually very on the like smaller side. The depth is small, but the width is big because, okay, again, it's rubberized. Everything is rubberized. That's amazing. Okay, now what happens is that you would be wondering, there's not storage space. There's storage space. Now you put things wherever you feel like. I kid you not. You can put things anywhere on the dashboard. And you're like, yeah, that's amazing, because what if you want to hide something? You can hide it behind this screen. Look, here's something which I had kept. I'd actually hidden it. How could I hide it? Because this screen is not occupying the back area, okay? So you can actually stuff things here. You can hide it. That's the secret hidden compartment of the Land Rover Defender. All right, too much excitement. There should be. There is a USB charging socket right there. There's a USB-C charging socket. There's another USB charging socket. There's a 12-volt charging socket. There's a wireless charging pad right there. So many options to charge inside this car. Absolutely insane. Okay, there's a sun visor. Okay, this is the most funny thing here. You get a light. This is not the funny part. The funny part is there's a sun visor in the center as well. Now, why is there a sun visor in the center? We'll come to that in a bit. Okay, there's a sun visor on the driver's side, obviously, with a light. And you can remove it and you can just block the sun if you so wish like. But why is this one in the center? I'll tell you why. There's a reason for the same. The reason is simple. This car can be optioned with three seats at the front. The center one would be a jump seat. So you can get this car with, I mean, depending on the 90 or the 110. Actually, you can decide if you want two seats at the front with a center console, or you want three seats with a jump seat. The middle seat would be a jump seat. Or you don't want anything in the center, so people can actually walk through here. I don't know why you want to walk through here to the rear when you can walk through the doors as such. Maybe it would be in the other variant, which happens to be the 90, wherein you want to walk into the rear, your choice. Now, who would actually get a jump seat? Because obviously this is occupying a lot of space in the center console. But there are people who actually, you know, search for quirks in cars and put their dogs right there, and they want a jump seat probably. But when you put that jump seat down, there are two cup holders as well. Now, in order to ensure all this jump seat stuff, they've put all the controls here on the dashboard, including the gear lever, which is nice. This is the engine start button. These are the controls for the air conditioning, the terrain modes and whatnot. I'll tell you how it works. You press this button and then you can decide what is the fan speed you want for the air conditioning. Okay, that is cool, right? Now, if you press this button, you can decide how you want the terrain response system to work. So you have got so many modes right there. Okay, you've got eco mode, you've got a comfort mode, and the regular off-road modes, which are grass, gravel and snow. No, plus mud rut program, all these programs, sand and rock crawl. It also has a program known as Wade, and then you can obviously configure it, and there's also auto function if you so wish. Okay, I'm just going to get into eco because I'm cheap AF right now, because this car is running on petrol power. This is the hazard light switch. Dashboard is big, really big, but quality of materials are really impressive in the sense. I'll tell you why it's impressive, because it's long lasting and it is rugged. Now, in case you're driving the car, you'd forget which car it is. They have said Defender right here. It doesn't say Land Rover on the steering wheel, it says Defender. But what if your co-passenger doesn't look at the steering wheel at all? Well, they've written Defender right there as well, so plenty of Defender. And you know what, it's got ambient lighting. Now, I have not been able to find the configurable option of changing ambient light. Maybe this particular variant doesn't have multiple colors, but here ambient light is there, which works really well at night. This is rubberized. This just comes in your hand like that. Twin cup holders, and this storage actually is not the best. Why, I'll tell you, because you are like, for the most part, I'm just going to keep stuff, and then you realize, oh my god, I just dropped stuff there, and my mobile phone has been dropping a lot of times. But there is so much space. There's actually space below here. There's so much space in this car. This car is super spacious. I love the way this thing has been done, the center armrest. And below here, you've got a cooled box. So you press this button twice for like, yeah, there for the faster setting. And there's light inside and it's chilling my mask right now. Meanwhile, it has also got plenty of other stuff which you would expect from a Land Rover these days, which is, of course, this, the clear side camera. Now, because obviously you can't see clearly with all the seats up, how do you see it? You press this button and that camera gets activated. There's a camera on the top, which I showed you earlier. This gets activated. This is the clear sight camera of this car, which is amazing. It's just amazing. The only thing is that you take some time to getting used to this. It's not the easiest to get used to. The steering wheel is actually too big for my liking. And again, this white treatment looks really very cool. This is for the cruise control. It doesn't have any such, you know what, modern autonomous tech other than adaptive cruise control. But, you know, these are the controls for the air conditioning. These are the controls for the audio system and voice command. And apparently in the brochure, it was saying, hello, Land Rover, and the car will respond. It's not responding to me. It doesn't like me at all. I am pretty sure about that. Okay, these are the controls for the wipers. Wipers work really well. And the spray actually comes out from the wipers itself. Yeah, the spray is inside the wiper. The nozzle is inside the wiper. That's also pretty cool. And here you see, these are the controls for the lights. Right, I have actually turned on the lights completely. I'm going to turn them off. Fog lights also, these are the controls for the fog lights. Turn them on as well. The steering wheel gets electric adjust both for reach as well as rake. Here you see, I'm moving it ahead and I'm moving it down. So electric adjust for the steering wheel. And this is a 10-inch instrument cluster, which is digital, completely digital, really very nice. And in order to browse through it, you can just press this button and there you see the options are there. Multitude of options. You can decide whatever you want, including tire pressure monitor as well. But you know what? I mean, it's not the fastest to actually browse through. The Mercedes system is just faster. And somehow the overall graphics of Mercedes cars is also better for the instrument cluster. You can get into layout and decide how you want the layout there. This is the two dial one. There's a one dial one as well, wherein, you know, yeah, you see the map on one side and you can get a full map if you so wish. I'm just going to get into exit out of this place right away. And there you see there's a complete map. Okay, there. That is so freaking cool. I love it. I love the way this thing has been done. Although I just wish it was just much more easier to browse through. And this actually changes its color basis. What? Of course, what menu you are in. So for audio controls and all that, depending on the menu on this screen, that changes, of course. So it's very adaptive, but this is of plastic, okay? Unlike in other Range Rover cars, which is piano black, which loves fingerprints like nobody else's business. Seats are so comfy. I can keep raising the seats as long as I wish. I'll turn off that light to save electricity. Okay, this is a new infotainment system. This is a 10-inch unit and they call it, I think, Pixo Pro or something of that. So I don't remember the name because it's so confusing. But I'll tell you what, this is fantastic. But before that, let me show you. This is to actually increase the ride height of the car. This is to decrease the ride height of the car. And this is obviously, I mean, low range. And this is for the traction control, which is one of the most important buttons for me, personally speaking, downhill assist. So all the buttons are here itself. And this is for the volume control, of course. Now let's do one thing. Let's get into reverse. This is the reverse parking camera. Now when I use the wipers, okay, this is the front wiper which I was using. Let me use the rear wiper. You see, there is water being sprayed on the camera to clean it, and you can see a bit of the spare wheel too. Now the camera is really very advanced because it gets this 360 degree view, which is good, but you know what, it gets a bird's eye view as well. This is so cool. I love the bird's eye view on this car. This is the most amazing thing about this car. I love it. You know what, it's very similar to what we see in BMW cars, but Land Rover has done a great job of designing it. It's quite accurate and looks splendid. And I mean, yeah, you can obviously decide to see it from the car's view as well if you don't like birds, okay? But this is a fantastic camera. Love it. Absolutely mind-blowing. In fact, it has got off-road cameras as well, which is showing you this thing, the front wheels, both left and right. And you see I'm changing the steering wheel and you can see that there as well. It's very you know, convenient when you're going off the road. So there's so much to explore. It also shows you a below the car view in case there is something there as well. Okay, let's get inside. Now it's got something known as weight sensing. What it tells you, there's a camera which is able to monitor. Yeah, there's a camera which is able to monitor how deep you are in water. I mean, how deep in water you are. So right now saying 800 mm. Actually, it is between 700 to 900 mm. So if I press this button there, the ride height is increasing, raising vehicle height, and 900 mm of water wading capacity. Absolutely crazy. This is TR Info basically. TR Info is the terrain response system info. It tells you what all changes are happening in various modes. Now you can configure this as well, but this weight sensing is super duper awesome. This slope assist, which tells you how much slope angle you're getting into, you just press this button. There's so much tech inside this car. It's absolutely brilliant. You know, it also tells you how much energy impact. It's a connected car. It's saying 4G right there. So it has got connected car tech as well. And then I can just browse through whatever information I want. This is for audio system, driving style, 61% economy. Well, I've not even got onto the throttle and saying 25.4 liters per 100 kilometers. That's what petrol does to you. And this is the Compass. So yeah, not the Wrangler. Jokes are getting bad and bad as time passes. Meanwhile, you know, here you get all the information like climate, cameras, valet mode, eco data, 4x4i, weight sensing, low traction launch. Low traction launch is basically if you get stuck, I mean, the car will get you out. It says, you know, make sure the vehicle is stationary, foot off the accelerator, activate these functions, and there it will automatically help you get out of shit. That is again very cool. So everything is nicely done here. The most funny part is that it has also vehicle dimensions. Okay, it tells you the dimensions of the vehicles. If you're like driving along and you're like, I never thought what would be the height of this car. What do I do? Well, nothing. You just go into this menu and see the height. Now, it actually changes its height depending on the ride height. Now, I'm decreasing the ride height. It says normal ride height selected on the infotainment system here. You see access height selected and all that. So it actually changes stuff there as well. That is so freaking cool. Okay, coolness is amazing in this car. Okay, amazing. And storage space is so plenty. Let's do one thing. Let me again get into this function. Okay, and this is the button for navigation. So navigation is inbuilt as well. So many features in this car, but you honestly don't care much about it. What you care about is obviously four-wheel drive and 4x4 and all those things. This is my favorite menu in this car. You can keep playing with the system all day long. There's so much information. Eco data is basically telling you eco tips and all those things, which you honestly don't need. If you're bought a Defender, you really don't care much about the environment because of the footprint of this car, which is massive, which is an understatement. It's more than massive. It's humongously humongous. So you see, all the information you get in both the screens, this new one is fantastic without a doubt. And it just makes things so easy. Now, it has got a Meridian sound system, which depending on the variant could be 160 watts, 400 watts, or even 700 watts of output. Now, I need to play an audio, which means that I would... Firstly, let me show you how the air conditioning thing works. You can actually select... I need to turn this on. You can select how you want it and you can sync it. And you can also check the second row and how it's working in the third row. All these things can be done. I'll just turn it off for the moment. Okay, I'm turning it on by mistake. Here, we turn it off. Let me get into audio and play an audio right away. Audio quality is absolutely fantastic, really very nice, because this has Meridian sound system with amazing speakers and very good insulation and build quality, so you don't hear any vibrations. That is how well this car is made. Now, one thing I really love about Land Rovers is that attention detail is really good. What happens is most of the time I come home at night, I leave this open, the sun blind always, and next day what happens is I get out late. By the time I come out, the sun has already dominated the interior. The interior is boiling hot. However, Land Rover, what it does is it will automatically shut this as soon as you turn off the car and leave. So here we're going to turn off the car. Yeah. And when you turn off the car, now you see how it shows this Land Rover thing. In fact, you won't believe it. When you actually turn on the car, it shows this nice graphic here as well. Where's the key? I've kept the key somewhere. Yeah, there I've dropped the key. Now, once I shut this and get out here, I have shut this and I have got out. As soon as I lock the car, this car will be like, okay, you know what? I'm going to shut the sun blind on the top. I don't know if you can see it. No, we can't see it. This thing is a bit tinted. Yeah, there it's shutting it. There it is shutting it. You can see it a bit. So that again is a nice feature. And obviously you can press a button and you can open all the windows of the car. Yeah, that is a feature which is there on almost every premium car. You can also open the sunroof. All the windows go down completely. That's amazing. And there the sunroof is opening along with the sunblind as well. So yeah, nice nifty feature to have, because just to get hot air from inside to the outside and cool the compartment. Now, as soon as you get inside, and here I have, now one, let me shut the door. Yes. Now when I turn the car, okay, you know, it has to have a reset of sorts. Now the thing is that the doors are really heavy. Okay, they won't shut on you by mistake, unfortunately. To someone, with the stick of truth, it had happened, the door automatically shut and the person fell down. But usually the doors don't move because they're very heavy. You have to put in some effort to move them. But let's just get driving, because the excitement is so much that I've spoken about the full car in more than 25 minutes. I don't even know why I blabber so much. All right, we are all set to go, which means turning off the air conditioning off. There's no drive mode as such. So we get into drive, we get into sport, and left foot on the brake, right foot on the accelerator. My hand will not reach. Nuren, can you turn the hazard light off? Thank you so much. Revving the motor and yeah, 0 to 100 kilometers per hour takes around 7.5 seconds. Acceleration is decently brisk, but honestly, this is not the engine you should get your Defender in, because this is the P300, and as the name suggests, it produces 300 horsepower at 5,500 RPM. That's the reason, post 5,500 RPM, it doesn't really have the grunt. It kind of struggles in the top end beyond that, but it goes all the way to 6,500 RPM, which is a good thing. So performance is actually okay, it's average. It gets the job done for sure. You know why? There is some lag lower down. So there's low end lag, and then, you know, it doesn't have the grunt in the low end of the rev range, but the mid range is really very strong. Hard on the gas, and this 8-speed torque converter gearbox, which is sourced from ZF, does a decent job indeed to get you the right gear, but it's not the fastest in terms of shifts, and I really miss paddle shifters here, although I can obviously manually take control of gears like this. Now we are in 8th gear, so the engine becomes really very calm. Now the torque output of 400 Newton meters comes in at a rather low 1500 RPM and peaks at 4000 or 4500 RPM, depending on which brochure you're reading from Land Rover, because I read two brochures in which there were separate numbers. I don't know why that glitch is there, but anyways, let's downshift. So yeah, it actually sounds quite nice and sporty in spite of the fact that it's brilliantly insulated, this car. The insulation levels are so good. I mean, I'm super impressed. Now, there's something on a slope assist and all. I understand everything you want to tell me. Okay, when you apply brakes, check this out. Okay, it's showing the tilt angle to be massive, like 13 degrees and whatnot. And then it's showing uphill angle. What the? I mean, the car did not go uphill at all. So yeah, this could be a little bit more accurate for sure. We're going to change the layout to a full map one just for fun. All right. And left foot on the brake, right foot on the accelerator. Let's see if manual control of gear shift actually happens. So here I am actually in first, revving the motor. You can hear it revs, but it shifts. It will not hold on to a gear. So it's not really manual mode, it's more of sport mode in this car. Now, the problem here is the weight of this vehicle. It is 2,300 odd kgs. And with this engine, it doesn't have the slickest of performance as such. Yeah, it could have done with more grunt, but then there is the P400 as well, which obviously is the 6-cylinder version. This is a 4-cylinder, 2-liter turbocharged petrol engine. The P400 is obviously 400 horsepower. And then there is the D300, which is 300 horsepower diesel 6-cylinder. That is the one to get, but it's a little bit too pricey. We'll get to that in a bit. By the way, there's also a D240, not on sale in India. It is on sale abroad, which is like a 4-cylinder version, a 4-cylinder diesel actually. But the diesel torque is what an SUV of this weight, height and whatnot deserves to have. I love the way this full map view is. It's so stunning. It looks really very nice indeed. But the thing is that for most people who don't really push their cars hard and fast, they will not really want a more powerful engine, but the diesel is the one to get for the fuel economy. This one will offer you decent fuel economy, without a doubt. Fuel economy would be decent if you don't push it hard. However, take it from me in writing, the diesel is the one to get. And off we go. Now, there are a few things I need to tell you about. First and foremost, you know what? The attention detail is massive. You see those cameras which I was talking about, the bird's eye view? When you actually apply brakes, it shows brakes being applied on the 3D model as well. And this screen can be turned into black as well, black and white. Now, I put it on auto, but at night, it will shift colors just so that you can see it more clearly. And the mirrors obviously have the blind spot assist, which works brilliantly well. Actually, that is the most important feature in this car, considering the size of the vehicle. The steering wheel is actually quite light, but still offers good amount of feel and feedback. They've done a great job with the steering wheel in terms of overall feel and feedback, and the way it's so responsive somehow. Such bad roads, you don't care at all, because the ride quality is absolutely brilliant. There's so much suspension travel, and it's absolutely insane. And right now, you see, the ride height can be reduced with the press of button. It is on the lower setting, of course, because access height selected, it says, which is the lower ride height. Now, what happens is the dynamics of the car changes dramatically depending on where the air suspension is. Obviously, it's got air suspension. It's got independent suspension as well. It's a big departure from what is the Defender, actually, what was the Defender earlier on. I've driven the original as well. I've driven a lot of Defenders. I remember very clearly in 2013, I had gone to the UK to celebrate 65 years of Land Rover. And there I'd driven almost every version of Land Rover's models, including a lot of Range Rovers, ones with just body and whatnot. Trust me on this, there is a big change in the new Defender, because the old one was a body on frame platform, it had solid axles and whatnot. This is more conventional in that sense, it uses a monocoque platform. However, it's still very capable of the road, because this is the D7X aluminium architecture, a monocoque, which is very rigid, very stiff, and excellent off-road as well. In fact, it has got a slew of electronic aids to ensure that you're able to off-road without any hitch whatsoever. You know, it is so easy to off-road this car. It's absolutely hilarious how the Defender can conquer any given road. You know why? Because so many electronic systems. Obviously, it's got a low range transfer case, it's also got a central locking diff, a rear locking diff, and a slew of drive modes which alters a lot of parameters in this vehicle. Unfortunately though, there is no sport mode, because it doesn't really need a sport mode. What it needs is more oomph, which the diesel will obviously suffice because of the massive torque on offer. Now, there's a very funny thing which I don't understand. The top speed of every Defender, no matter which engine is powering it, is limited to not 190 kilometers per hour, but 191 kilometers per hour. I don't understand why they came to the number 191. Just top it out at 190, right? What is that one extra going to do to you? Now, I have to admit one thing, that the brakes are really very strong on this car. However, like slide nose dive, of course, but you know, the pedal is a bit too grabby, could have been a little bit more progressive in terms of stopping power. Taking a U-turn is so effortless, you don't feel the size of this car at all. That is how effortless it is to drive the Defender. Absolutely hilarious how this car, I mean, behaves. This is a car which will intimidate you by its size, and when you sit on it, you realize, oh my god, it's so wide. That mirror is like in, not even in this car, it's in another car altogether. And the length is like almost, the hood itself is 17 kilometers per long. That is so freaking hilarious. But what's the best thing is that the road presence is insane. People stop and turn around to look at this car, and you can obviously see the hood from your driving position. You can see almost everything. In fact, here is the beautiful eyesight camera, which I absolutely love. Not the eyesight, it's known as the clear sight. I don't know why I keep saying eyesight. Okay, it gives you eyesight some relief, maybe probably that's why. But this clear sight camera is phenomenal. Even in the dark, even at night, even when it's raining, you can see everything clearly. Now, steering wheel is fantastic. It has got, I mean, it is very light at low speed, but it's got fantastic weight as soon as you speed up, and it doesn't feel hairy at all. And that is the benefit of a monocoque platform. Sorry, Defender purists, but this had to happen. That's the reason why the Defender is so fantastic, because it's a car which can off-road very comfortably, yet it is so easy to drive in the city as well as out on the highway, and higher speeds also, it remains very stable, which is kind of surprising and shocking considering that this car has the aerodynamics of the refrigerator I have at my house. There's no concept of aerodynamics here, but still, I mean, it's able to cheat wind. I don't know how. Land Rover has done a fantastic job, and running on like non-tarmac tires, like off-road specific tires also, you don't hear much of the road noise or the wind noise or any of that. So again, noise insulation, fabulous. This car actually feels like a tank in the real sense. Yeah, just don't do quick lane changes, because then you can feel some amount of body roll. Yeah, there is of course plenty of body roll, which is obviously expected from a car of this size.
Review normal road pe chala ke kyun de rahe ho? This is an off-road car. Plain road pe chala ke kya maza hai?
Yeah, you can hear a bit of the noise if you really stress over it, but it, I mean, it's just so freaking comfortable. Ride quality is so brilliant, it decimates everything in its track. Big potholes, small potholes, anything, you name it, this car just glides over everything. That's the brilliance of the ride quality, in spite of, you know, the overall height and weight and design and whatnot. Still, handling is actually quite acceptable. Obviously, there's body roll, but for the most part, this is a car which is so good to handle. It's surprising to me, with no concept of aerodynamics, how is this car so good? In fact, you know, changing lanes, no problem at all. The gripe I have is that I think certain more features could have been offered, and the pricing could have been more competitive, because this one is priced at Rs 1.14 crores on Road Mumbai, which makes it quite expensive. However, you know, you can choose a less expensive variant. Actually, the range starts at just 97 lakhs, but that is for the base petrol. Okay, this is also the base petrol engine, but that's for the standard variant. This is the SE, and that is for the 90, the Defender 90, the one with three doors. But this is one with the five doors, and you know, the top end is the diesel, the D300X dynamic variant, which is actually priced at 1.4 crores on Road Mumbai, making it very pricey indeed. So how does Land Rover actually have 32 freaking variants of the Defender on offer. It's very simple, okay? First, it's not 32, it's 16 each for 90 as well as 110. And then there are actually four main variants. There's the standard, there's the S, there's the SE, there's the HSE. And then on top of that, they have two special editions. One is the first edition, and then there's the X Dynamic Edition. So when you factor in three engines, then they have 32 freaking variants on offer. That's a lot of variants to have in a car, creating a lot of confusion. But since this is a CV, you order it and they'll get it out from abroad. So there's no problem in terms of inventory stocking as such. You just have to wait, and that wait could be a bit daunting because you want your Defender. It's happened already because of some issues in terms of availability of parts and whatnot. There's a lot of delay in terms of getting Land Rover cars these days. They are in a lot of demand. So we're going to turn off traction control off. And here we go. Left foot on the brake, right foot on the accelerator. It doesn't actually care at all even if you turn off the traction control, because there's so much grip on offer with those wide tires. Nothing's gonna happen, no wheel spin, none of that. It's just pure performance. So to sum it up, this is the best Defender right now, one of the best SUVs in the world as well. Very practical, yet very capable. This is an all-rounder of sorts, and that is the reason why the Defender has actually justified all the hype which it has been getting. What a fantastic car, absolutely sensational. You know, only thing is the performance could have been better, but the diesel would suffice in that regard. However, ride, handling, appeal, features, equipment, off-road capability, everything, you name it, this car has it. Is it just me, or even I find the sound of this engine to be quite sporty as such? They have great insulation, but you can't hear much on the inside. I'm just imagining what the P400 would be. That would be amazing. That also gets battery tech, you know, so that's also amazing. But because of the bigger engine, obviously it's going to drink a lot more fuel in spite of having assistance from electric motors. But that's not the point right now. The point is, an SUV should be diesel. Just get the diesel and you are going to be happy. The Defender is fantastic. It's a lovely car. I love it. I find it very nice in almost every possible way, other than the fact that it's a little bit on the expensive side. There is not anything you would dislike about this car. That is how good the Defender is. And then a lot of tech is also there, you know, weight sensing. I already showed it to you before. You know, it's able to tell you how much you are in deep shit rather in water. That's also so cool. You can play with this system. Everything is fantastic to an entirely different level altogether. In fact, if there's one SUV you should be having, this is probably the only one which will suffice. And then coming to a corner, look at it. There is roll, but everything is so well measured that it's very much bearable. I like it. I love the Defender. Fuel tank capacity is 90 liters, and the fuel economy should be between 7 to 12 kilometers per liter depending on your driving style. But there's an eco mode which has been given just in order to consume fuel efficiency, and that you can see performance goes for a slight toss, but the stop start system awakens and it keeps shutting off the car every given moment, which is very, very, very irritating as such. But if you're buying a car of this price, you really don't care about fuel efficiency. And if you care about fuel efficiency, you should pay the additional 13 lakh rupees for the diesel, the D300, when compared to the P300, or 5 lakhs more when compared between the P400 and the D300, or the price difference between the P300 and the P400 is actually 8 lakh rupees. So they're charging a lot for different engines, but because 4 to 6 cylinders, the premium becomes quite a bit. But for the better fuel economy and the better performance, the premium is definitely worth it. And I would suggest you get the diesel. Now, part of this fantastic driving dynamics also goes to all the electronics which are there in this car. And the ground clearance is to an obnoxious 291mm when you put it on full height, which is like crazy. You need a stool to get inside the car for most. And then it has got torque vectoring by braking, which applies brakes to the inside wheel to ensure optimum traction. I mean, they've just put in so much tech, but it doesn't feel out of place. It doesn't feel intrusive at all. It feels very natural and progressive. And talking about progress, it's got something known as all-terrain progress control, which is nothing but cruise control for off-road driving. And then it has got low traction launch as well. You just press the button and it's going to make sure it launches from the trickiest of situations. This car actually makes you feel like a hero.